Welcome, everybody. I'm Johanna Arendt with Travis County Balcones Canyonlands Preserve. And this Wild Neighbor Speaker Series is a collaboration of Travis County Balcones Canyonlands Preserve and City of Austin Balcones Canyonlands Preserve, which are managed by the Natural Resources Program at Travis County and the Wildlands Conservation Program at the City of Austin. We're really happy to welcome Dr. Pamela Owen today to speak to us about armadillos. And I wanted to just talk a little bit about the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve, which is hosting this program. Before we get started, it'll be short and sweet. So we created this program as a way to connect folks with experts like Dr. Owen about the wildlife that we see in our area. As a very large urban preserve, we get a lot of questions from folks about all the wildlife we see. And so this is a great way to get all those questions answered and have that as a resource going forward online, since this will be recorded and available moving forward on our websites and on social media. So just moving forward on the slide, if I can, there we go. So that's a map of the Balcones Canyonlands Preserve, if you're not already familiar with it. It's pretty massive. It's 50 square miles, actually a little bit over that, which is one of the largest urban preserves in the country. And it's managed by lots of partners, as you can see from the different colors there. There's a legend down in the lower left-hand corner there, so you can see who everybody is. And it's an oasis of wildness in the city here. It was created to protect endangered and threatened species. And by doing that, it also protects the entire amazing rich ecosystem that we have here in the Balcones Canyonlands. It was also created as a form of mitigation. The land in this preserve will be protected in perpetuity. And that was done in exchange for allowing the majority of endangered species habitat in Western Travis County to be developed into roads and houses and all the things that we, you know, have to sustain our community. But in exchange for allowing that land to be developed, we've set aside this really massive over 30,000 acre preserve here, which is really a gem and a wonderful resource, not only for wildlife, but also for the community. In addition to doing all the things that wildlands do naturally, like, you know, helping to clean the water and air, mitigating flood and erosion, helping to mitigate the effects of climate change. It's also a resource for the community, community of wildlife, here are the protected species, and community of people surrounding the preserve and in the larger community. We have a lot of educational programs like this, guided hikes during non-COVID times, and also volunteer opportunities that are come up and are on our calendar. So please do get involved and get engaged and stay connected with us. We are looking forward to connecting with you even more once COVID has subsided. So here are a couple of links that are, we could give you a billion links, but here are two that will really be good to get you started. The first one is an interactive map of the preserve showing what areas are open to the public. And the second is the story of the BCP. That'll give you the background and all the partners and how to get involved. It's a really good resource that the City of Austin has. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our speaker for today. Dr. Pamela Owen is the Associate Director of the Texas Memorial Museum, which is the Natural History Museum at UT Austin. If you haven't been there yet, it's a really wonderful place. She's a mammalogist and vertebrate paleontologist, and she's been an informal science educator for 21 years. She has done research on saber-toothed cats, American lions, coyotes, and dire wolves, among many other things. So she's really one of the coolest people you'll ever meet, to be honest. So she's extremely knowledgeable and always really wonderful to hear from. And so if you have questions for Dr. Owen during the presentation, please put it in the Q&A section down at the bottom, not in the chat section. So put it in the Q&A, and at the end, my colleague Jeremy Hull will be reading those questions to Dr. Owen for discussion. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen so that Dr. Owen can share hers.
Okay. Everyone sees the screen, I hope. Good afternoon. I am so happy to be talking with you today about armadillos, which are this fabulous creature, in my personal opinion. Throughout history, they've played different roles with different people in terms of attitudes and experiences. And I kind of want to start with just two of my favorite memories about armadillos. Once I moved here from California, moved to Texas, I got to know armadillos very well. Two in particular. One is that I went camping at the Guadalupe River State Park one summer weekend and spent the night following armadillos. I was entertaining my sister who was in from out of town who wanted to see live armadillos, not a road-killed armadillo, but some live armadillos. And so we had gone camping and yeah, so all around flashlights, it was very exciting. And we thought, wow, we got our fill of armadillos. But what was crazy is they kept us up all night rooting around the tent, making grunting noises, kind of just a circus. I had never heard or seen so much activity. So that's something that's kind of near and dear to my heart, that memory. And then my second memory is kind of associated with some of my background and looking at deep time and looking at the fossil record. And I participated in a program, about 10 years ago that was on the Discovery Channel called Prehistoric Dallas. And I had the opportunity to meet and hold a live nine-banded armadillo called Speed Bump. As part of this television program, and obviously I was talking about armadillos and some of their extinct relatives, and I'll use my little pointer here to point this out, the glyptodont that I have here on this title slide. That's our giant fossil armadillo that we have at Texas Memorial Museum, and so I always love to talk about armadillos, so I'm so happy to share some information about them and kind of look at them in terms of deep time. So let's see if we can forward. This way. Okay. So when you say armadillo, especially in the Austin area, you might not even think about roadkill armadillos or live armadillos running across the street or, you know, these little armored tanks that are digging little holes in your backyard. You might come across them with all this fabulous advertising. So armadillos have become rather iconic, especially here in Austin. We see them utilized in businesses and big public events. And so armadillos, you know, very, very popular figure in terms of our, you know, pop culture. So let's just get back, think about what armadillo means and the names and the titles to kind of give it some place and you know, give them some respect. So starting off with the scientific name, I love the scientific names. They got such great history with them. And so the scientific name for armadillos is from Linnaeus. Is Dasypus novum cinctus, and he Latinized the Greek word for hair, Dasypus, with novum cinctus, which means nine belts. So novum meaning nine, cinctus meaning belt. You think about a cinch. And so that's where our Texas armadillo gets its scientific name. Before Linnaeus, you know, our native peoples of Texas and Central America, we have languages, Nahuatl is one of them. And so Ayotochtli is the name for armadillos, which is roughly translated as turtle rabbit. And of course, the Spanish, when they came into Texas, the name armadillo, you're looking at little armored one. During the 30s, during the Great Depression, Texans often used different names for armadillos. That included names such as Hoover hog, poverty pig, poor man's pig, because they were a food source. And armadillos have been a food source for centuries, for thousands of years. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. And then one point I wanna make is that, you know, our armadillo actually has a state title. It was adopted as a Texas small state mammal on the 16th of June in 1995 by House Concurrent Resolution number 178. And it was signed by Governor George W. Bush. So yes, our nine-banded armadillo has some respect. It is our Texas small state mammal. So what is an armadillo? So if we look at family trees, if you look at the tree on the left, that shows you cingulata. That's just the name for armadillos and their kin. And we're familiar with our single species, but they're very, very diverse in South America. So cingulata is the armadillo group, and they're related to anteaters and sloths. And they belong to a group we call the Xenarthra. And Xenarthra means strange joints. And I'll show you an image of where that comes from. If we look into the armadillo family tree in detail, you can see that all those branches, we've got extinct and extant. So those are the living species, different groups. Our armadillo belongs to this group here, the Dasypodines. So we'll be mostly talking about this group this morning. But I will point out the glyptodonts, this creature right here with this really strange kind of, you know, bulldog-like skull. I'll point out the glyptodonts because we have a nice local record to compare with our living species. So we'll focus on those two, just to give you an idea of kind of family relationships. So I mentioned Xenarthra, the name strange joints, and that name comes from the fact that there's an extra articulation. So we're looking at the bones that make up the back, the vertebral column, of a rabbit with a nine-banded armadillo. And so in most mammals, we've got kind of a single kind of connection with our, we call it zygapophysis, but we also have an extra connection between vertebrae that's called a Xenarthrous process. So it's just an extra joint, extra connection. And it's thought that a lot of that anatomy may have provided some extra stability, because those of you that know and love, or maybe know and not so love, armadillos and their digging capabilities, you know, they are transmitting a lot of forces as they're moving those forelimbs. And so perhaps that, you know, the vertebral column can assist with that. The Xenarthrin is a group. So armadillos and the sloths and the anteaters are also well known for their claws. So I've been mentioning digging. We really know that. That's something that they all share in common. But when we really focus on armadillos, we see something really interesting. Especially our long-nosed group, the Dasypodids, where our nine-banded belongs, really long snout with these tiny little peg-like teeth. And what's interesting about all the members of Xenarthra is that their teeth lack enamel. So that really hard, shiny stuff that, you know, protects the crowns of our teeth, we don't see that. So they have mineralized teeth, just no enamel on there. And they're peg-like, and they have a 30 to 32 total within their upper and lower jaws. So they've got a really kind of long snout with these teeth. And you kind of think, well, you know, those teeth, what are they great for chewing things? Well, I kind of look at them as kind of exoskeleton crunchers. They're not going to be really going to town grinding, you know, and slicing, but, you know, basically piercing the prey that they eat. But these teeth, you'll notice that it's mostly just the back teeth. You don't see any, you know, canines or incisors up in the front. Everything's going on in the back. So they kind of look like a very tiny, like a miniature, like dolphin skull. What makes armadillos, of course, very famous is that the armor itself. And what's really interesting about this armor, it's different from the armor that we see in reptiles like turtles, or, you know, some of the osteoderms that we see in the skin of alligators and crocodiles. This armor is dermal, which means it grows in the dermal layer of the skin. So unlike a turtle or a tortoise, you may be aware that their shell is formed from not only the sternum, but also, you know, their vertebral column. So it's a completely different way of armoring itself. With the armadillos, it's all within the skin. And so you've got then what we call these little osteoderms, individual plates, that are covered with this keratin layer, the plates over that. So the armor is really interesting because it gives protection and yet, you know, some amount of flexibility, some amount of flexibility. So when we look at our living armadillo, you're looking at animals that are roughly what, a foot and a half long. They're little, you know, 12 pound tanks. The females tend to be a little bit way less than the males. So, you know, your average weights are going to be somewhere between, you know, 8 and maybe 17 pounds maximum. Moving it about, when we look at the armor itself, it's broken up into what we call these bucklers. So we've got shoulder shield and kind of hip shield. We've got the bands here. typically 9, but do know that our 9 banded armadillos can have between 7 and 11. So there's a little bit of genetic play in there. So, but you know, averaging 9. So those are the bands here that give it some flexibility. Our armadillos cannot roll into a ball. So they can kind of do the cashew, can bend, gives them that flexibility there, but there's only one species of armadillo, and it's in South America, that can literally roll up into a ball. So the stories about our Texas armadillos rolling up in a ball and heading downhill, those are all stories. You'll notice also that the armor extends all the way down to the tail. So we've got these rings of armor here. And then there's a little face shield that covers up the snout. And so that makes up the armor. And the underside is all skin and you know, it's lightly haired. So one thing that really struck me when I held Speed Bump was that he was dumping a lot of heat. You could really feel his belly that were some of the heat, but obviously not a super warm animal. They have relatively low body temperatures. And so we're typically seeing them in environments where not only do we have plenty of water, but we don't have long extended freezing cold winters. Armadillos are known for digging. And so again, the claws, the front feet have 4 major claws, 4 digits, and then the hind feet have 5. Those claws are really robust. And of course they use them to create these dens that can have more than one opening. And they use leaves and grass to bed those down. Some of these burrows actually act as food traps. So all kinds of really cool invertebrates that are moving about in the soil or dropping in to some of these burrows. It's like they have their own little cache of food. So they have sort of a sleeping burrow, and then they might have some other entrances that kind of serve as these food traps. But this is what a lot of people kind of recognize and might be concerned with, especially on your property if you're concerned with armadillo damage about all the digging. But one thing I will say about armadillo burrows is that quite often their burrows serve as great shelter spaces for other wild creatures. So everything from rattlesnakes, to ground squirrels and other animals take advantage of these burrows. Burrows in general, if I were to kind of, if you wanted to go out on your property and kind of and look for the best places for armadillo burrows, they're typically moving soil that is near streams or rivers or some kind of water source. So part of what we have learned with armadillo kind of dispersal and distributions, that soils do have some control about that. So places where there is a lot of clay, so if you move into like Blackland Prairie, you see fewer armadillos, but you have sandier soils that are easier for them to move about, you're going to see a higher abundance of those animals. So what are they doing as they're digging around? Well, they're looking for food. And despite some of the early contentions that armadillos were consuming corpses or destroying the nests and the eggs of ground-dwelling birds, predominantly their diet are invertebrates. And so 93% of their diet, it's estimated, is all animal-based proteins. So especially, larval adult insects. And those include those insects that we humans find to be kind of detrimental to some of our agricultural practices, or termites. You think about you don't want termite infestations in your homes. They're going after earthworms, millipedes, also known to take some crayfish. And then what few kind of non-animal materials that have been found in some studies of stomach contents include things like fungus, and every once in a while berries, but it's thought that perhaps they're not actually selecting for those items, that they just happen to be, as they're rooting around snuffling things up, that some of that material gets in there. But predominantly, we're looking at invertebrate material. So what's interesting about armadillos is that they have a seasonal activity pattern. So right now, it's the start of kind of the birthing season. So we're going to start to see some switching in terms of being most active during kind of the warmest part of the day. As we move into the summer, we start to see them more active during the evening. So when I was out camping, you know, in Guadalupe River, that was in the summer. And so that's, we waited till nighttime. So they're moving about, you know, they do like the warmth, but you know, we know how it is in this Texas summer is like gonna take the shade during the day. So weather like this, we're gonna see a little bit more activity where there's more sunshine and more warmth. And then also a time where the females are gonna start having young. I already kind of talked a little bit about just kind of soil preferences and where some of the digging takes place. One really cool thing about armadillos is that we typically see them associated in places where we have, you know, permanent water source. So usually working along streams and riverbanks, they're also known to, you know, to go underwater and literally kind of run across the bottom of the stream to get to the other side. And what's interesting, they're also known for taking some air in, and it's not understood physiologically how this is happening, but somehow they are able to ingest air and kind of inflate part of their digestive system so they give them a little bit more buoyancy. It's not thought that they're purposely going into the water searching for food or, you know, enjoying food, trying not to anthropomorphize, but it's not as if they're, you know, actively swimming, but apparently they've got this great adaptation that allows them to deal with crossing rivers or streams as needed. But a lot of their dispersal has been kind of following the major river systems. So I kind of briefly mentioned that we're moving into our birthing season. So March is, you know, typically kind of becomes the high time that we start to see baby armadillos coming out of the birth burrow. And so one thing about our nine-banded armadillo has got two ways of reproducing that are really, really interesting. The first component is that they express what is called delayed implantation, which means that the fertilized egg after mating doesn't actually implant within the uterine wall. So it kind of free floats for a while before implanting about 14 weeks after fertilization. So that's typically, you know, we're thinking, so a lot of the mating really kicks into gear in July. So 14 weeks later, it's going to be about November, we'll get implantation. And it's thought that that delay is an adaptation so that the young are not born in the middle of winter, which again, because armadillos are not the greatest thermoregulators, you know, they lose so much heat, you know, obviously they're not hairy, that this is a great adaptation that's allowed for their success. So having that, what's interesting is that once that fertilized egg then starts to divide and go through the process of developing into embryos, nine-banded armadillos also have what we call polyembryony, which means that they give birth to multiple identicals. And in the case of our nine-banded armadillos, they're quads. So all the babies, you get four identical quadruplets. That's the typical, that's the way that they reproduce. So it's absolutely fascinating. So you have the youngsters out, and you see the four out here, identicals. When the youngsters are born, they eyes are open. They're kind of really, really ready to go. It's within hours, they're moving about. They do have their dermal armor in place, but it's not solid. So it gives them that flexibility, and it's not going to get kind of to the solid state that we see until they're adults. So moving into that first year. So that gives them that flexibility, that growth. But you can see the armor and you can see the osteoderm pattern on them. They really only nurse for probably less than, you know, 2 months, and then they're ready to go forage and hang out with mom. They actually kind of stay with the mother, it's thought, for some time, but foraging for the worms and the insects and things that makes up their diet. All right, so speaking of diet, what and who eat armadillos? So it's interesting, we think about in the wild, quite often, especially if you're talking to school-age children, you're thinking about, okay, predator-prey relationships, you know, who's eating armadillos? And it's interesting, most of the our main predators will at times take armadillos. So that it would include our wildlife, local wildlife like coyotes and bobcats. But we also see some dogs as the main killers of armadillos, as well as feral hogs are have been documented in Texas as predators of especially the young. I will say that humans have been consuming armadillos for thousands of years. And we have people today are still consuming armadillos. And I honestly have not tried it. I think if somebody would offer me armadillo, I definitely would try. From what I've read and from descriptions from folks that have traveled not only here in Texas and in Louisiana and Mexico and into Central and Southern Americas, that the dishes that are prepared, that they're, it's been equated to pork, so you can't use the old like taste like chicken story with armadillo. But yeah, people have been consuming armadillos for thousands and thousands of years. And armadillos do make up a prey item for you, some of our local wildlife. So where do we find armadillos in Texas? Just about all over the state. So this is a map. You can see the gray shaded areas where we see them. So just that kind of far western, really dry regions of the state, we don't see armadillos. The black dots are just official county records. So just the seeing no black dot in Williamson County doesn't mean there's no armadillos there. Those are just the official records. This is from the online version of the Mammals of Texas, which is a great resource if you are not familiar with it. One of the great stories about armadillos, of course, is this kind of big trek that they have made across the state. So here are two maps. This was published by David Schmidley in his book on the natural history of Texas. And you can see that Texas A, we're looking at, you know, early by in the 1800s, and then we move into about 2002, there's that map there. So we've even extended, you know, further into West Texas. The earliest reports of our extant species date from the late 1840s. And by 1900, they were present across the Edwards Plateau. And then we actually have an official report from one along the banks of Onion Creek in Travis County. So I'm interested in deep time. And so, you know, we need to think about armadillos and, you know, what it was like, you know, before we see, you know, seen this kind of growth in, and not only the kind of distribution of armadillos as they march across the state, but also just the growth of our own cities and suburbs here in Texas. And so here are just three records of what we call subfossil remains. So we're not looking at stuff that's very old. You can kind of call them very old bones. And I do want to point out Miller's Cave is an interesting site. This is a bone that came out of a brown clay layer that's been dated at, you know, a little shy of 3,000 years ago. So some of the information about armadillos, you know, not coming in till the 1840s, you know, we really need to kind of look at the fossil record to kind of think about, you know, how, you know, exact is that information. And then there's the McKinney Homestead. So those of you that have been to McKinney Falls State Park, there's a record of an armadillo that, you know, could be as old as, you know, 97, you know, years. So armadillos, you know, we do get a little bit of some of these old bones in our record. What makes the story of nine-banded armadillos so interesting is that there is a Pleistocene species called Dasypus bellus. So again, our nine-banded is Dasypus novum cinctus. Dasypus bellus means beautiful armadillo. And I'll show you an image of some of the fossils here in a sec. But Dasypus bellus, our beautiful armadillo, essentially it looks exactly like a nine-banded armadillo, but about twice the size. And it was present within Texas during, you know, the last ice age. And so when we start looking at the data, so this map is from this fabulous paper where Shapiro and her gang collected data of beautiful armadillo fossils. And so we've got the black dots are all these localities. So there's Miller's Cave there. And compared that to what we see as the current range of our nine banded armadillo in the dark gray. The light gray is the projected expanse, because now we're seeing, you know, armadillos popping up into places that we hadn't seen them before. You know, so you see that Tennessee's become all of a sudden a hot spot for armadillos. But looking at the fossils and looking at the ranges, some of the results of their research indicate that we might have to reconsider whether or not the Pleistocene species that we call beautiful armadillo might in fact actually be the same species as our nine-banded armadillo, and that this single species, if we were to accept that, is actually an armadillo that is very adaptable in terms of body size and response to climatic change. We're already seeing that in our extant species, right? So we're seeing this great movement. And with, you know, climate change, you know, this is going to continue. So here I mentioned Dasypus bellus. So again, looks, just imagine just a giant nine-banded armadillo. Here are some of the osteoderms. So those are the bones that make up, you know, the bands and the bucklers there to give you an idea of size. We've got, you know, several locations in Texas where we can actually find fossils of them. And this just to give you a list, I'm not expecting you to read them, but mostly just give you an idea that, hey, we've got several species, several sites where the fossils have been found. And I do want to point out one right here, Lobach Cave, number 3 in Williamson County. For those of you who've been to Interspace Cavern, that's the cave. That's the original name of the cave when the excavations were done and when it was first discovered back in the 1960s. And we actually have a radiocarbon date from some of the fossils that have come out of that cave, not specifically from the beautiful armadillo there, but we're looking at this animal being present in central Texas, you know, 23,000 years ago, so during the last ice age. So again, I bring this up because it's an interesting thought to think that, ah, this species that we've come to know and love, if we agree that the beautiful armadillo is just essentially a large ice age version of the same species, has been around for, you know, well over 20,000 years. Fascinating, just absolutely fascinating. So the other extinct armadillo relative I want to point out that not as closely related to our nine banders as our the beautiful armadillo is something that we call a glyptodont, and that means carved tooth. So glypt meaning carved, odont, when you see that in scientific words, always means tooth. And the name comes from just a description of the teeth that look more, instead of being like pegs, they're kind of cut, diagonals cut into them. And so that's where that carved comes from. So the skull is really short snouted. They're really recognizable by these giant kind of flanges of bone that come out the cheeks. Those are for muscle attachment. So they were processing probably much more plant material. So different from armadillos, the glyptodonts were primarily herbivorous. And so had, you know, kind of modifications of skull, these adaptations that allowed this kind of shredding and grinding of grasses. They've got this giant carapace. So glyptodonts kind of stand out because you don't see the bands in the middle. So it looks like one giant shield or one giant buckler. And each of these osteoderms, each of these single bones are really characteristic. And they got this kind of little rosette, little flower pattern. And that's how we can recognize individual, you know, glyptodonts, because quite often in the fossil record, we don't get the whole skeleton and we might get just an isolated osteoderm. And so that kind of beautiful flower pattern is really identifiable for us. So I bring up the glyptodonts because we've got this fabulous shell here and tail of a glyptodont, Glyptotherium, which is one of our Texas glyptodonts that was living here during the last ice age. It's kind of front and center in our ice age exhibit here at Texas Memorial Museum. That particular shell came from Ingleside, so in San Patricio County. So it was part of a huge assemblage of sloths and pampatheres and other wonderful ice age creatures that came from a site that was actually discovered by a Works Progress Administration crew that was digging caliche to build roads during the during the Depression. So the road team actually made the find there in Ingleside. It's also called the Tedford Pit, if you look at some of the older literature, but that is where this individual came from. But I also want to point out that locally, from that same cave where we get the beautiful armadillo, we have some of the osteoderms that show that we had glyptodonts here as well. What's interesting about glyptodonts is that the distribution is primarily kind of Gulf coastal. So we have a really large sample that comes out of Florida and a great sample out of Texas. And it was thought initially that these animals were kind of tied to more kind of riparian or wetland environments, but there's been some kind of reevaluation, especially when looking at some of the glyptodonts, which are much more diverse in South America, and looking at the possibility that instead what they were more open environment and feasting on the grasses in the areas, and especially when we think about, you know, Ice Age in Williamson County, we think about glyptodonts and giant armadillos. And so that looking at other fossil assemblages, it seems to indicate that, yeah, they were kind of these open area environment living creatures, kind of similar to what we're seeing in South America today. And then here's Miller's Cave again. We've got glyptodont that came out of there. So it's interesting that some of these fossil sites are preserving our kind of our armadillo record pretty well here locally. So when we think about, you know, the giant shells that we see in the glyptodonts, and then kind of move forward, so fast forward to kind of modern day times, we think about, well, those shells are just extraordinary, right? And again, they're made of bone. And it always makes me think about this really interesting business called the Appelt Armadillo Company. And it was in Comfort, Texas, in operation from 1889 to 1971. And their heyday was in the 1930s. And so this is actually an advertisement from Popular Science in 1934. And where company is advertising that you could get an armadillo lampshade, you could get armadillo baskets were all the rage, and you still see a lot of armadillo baskets out there. And if you haven't done this, get out on the internet and just like search for armadillo art or armadillo baskets. And you know, people today are still, you know, utilizing armadillo materials or the armadillo shape or the armadillo kind of essence. Become, you know, so important and so kind of ingrained in kind of our Texas way of being. You know, you just kind of look around, you've got all the, you know, obligatory taxidermy armadillos drinking, we've got, you know, armadillo gunslinger ceramics, we've got beautiful armadillo street art, you know, on murals. So, you know, really they become part of, you know, our culture and more of a whimsical part of our culture in many ways. And then of course, you know, we're thinking about the weather. February, we just kind of missed Groundhog Day, or in this case, you know, here in Texas, we've got kind of Armadillo Day with BK Bob that took on Punxsutawney Phil in terms of predicting and prognosticating, thinking about the weather. I was really sorry that Bob couldn't come out and entertain the crowds because, you know, we're still dealing with the COVID year. I do have to kind of ask about the early spring, because after last week, I certainly wasn't feeling it last week, that early spring, and I think Punxsutawney Phil actually got it right this time. But we did have an 80 degree day though, did recently, so we, you know, BK Bob may actually be right this year. That's fingers crossed, everybody, right? Fingers crossed. And to end open up for questions, I just want to end by reading some of the language from House Concurrent Resolution number 178, which again was signed by Governor George W. Bush in 1995. And I just want to read you the language to end my talk today. And this is the language about why the armadillo should become our small state mammal of Texas. The armadillo possesses many remarkable and unique traits, some of which parallel the attributes that distinguish a true Texan such as a deep respect and need for the land, the ability to change and adapt, and a fierce, undying love for freedom. And with that, I thank you, and I look forward to answering your questions.
That was great. Thank you so much. So much good information there. I think that was great. We do have a lot of questions here, and so I'll start going through them. Some we'll be able to do kind of rapid fire. Some of them are a little more in depth. Folks, if you have more questions added to the Q&A, we'll get to as many of them as we can. And then, of course, you could take down Dr. Owen's contact information there and follow up with her if we don't get to any questions. So the first question came up right at the beginning when you were talking about the family tree. And it said, how come the anteater and the sloths don't have any kind of shell or armoring?
Oh, that's a fabulous question. So let me give you a little interesting information about extinct sloths. So when we look at, so today we think about tree sloths. We've got the two, Bradypus and Colepus are their names. So the two-toed and three-toed sloths. We don't really think about any armor, and we don't think about their giant cousins very often, unless you're really into the Ice Age. But some of their Ice Age relatives, including a species called Paramylodon harlani, which is a sloth that we had here in Texas, and we have a beautiful skeleton that came out of that Ingleside site from the coast near Corpus Christi. It's on exhibit at the museum. What has been found with that particular species is that embedded in the skin, so in the dermal layer, are these small, olive pit sized little osteoderms. And that's really what they look like. And so some of the giant ground sloths of the last ice age actually had some hidden armor. And it's these little bone. Again, just imagine having a whole series of little olive pits embedded in your skin, especially along the back. They actually did have some armor. And so it's interesting that there obviously is some genetic coding that initiates some kind of armor growth. I don't think anybody knows the answer to whether or not, this is something that's ancestral to the group. And, I would say yes, given that we see these little weird little osteoderms in the skin of extinct ground sloths. It's just that particular gene that codes for that, or genes probably, it's probably a very complex suite of genes, has been turned off, and just not something that we see in the anteaters and the living sloths of today. But our armadillo branch of that family tree has retained that set of characteristics, and I think much to their advantage.
Very cool. This next question came up in several different configurations, so I'll kind of combine a few of them. It was, what is the armadillo's main sense out of the five senses? And then we had some folks ask, why are their ears so big? Can they see? Do they have smell? So kind of all together.
So they have a great sense of smell. And so they're utilizing that as they're doing their rooting. So, and what's great is they have a, really elongated snout. So they've got kind of extensive kind of mucosa that allows them to take those kind of olfactory particles back into the brain. They have relatively, good hearing. Their sight is probably their weakest sense. I would put smell as number one, most definitely.
Okay. How far down can they dig? Do you have any idea how far those burrows go?
So some of the burrows, I think I've seen them described as maybe a few feet down, but instead of depth, especially if you're digging along riverbanks, is extension. So some of their burrows may extend, upwards of 16 feet in length. So it's not so much the depth for them. So it could be, pretty surface. And the openings are really large enough to get their body through. So you're looking at, 8 or 9 inches, right? And then maybe just a few, you know, handfuls of centimeters down or maybe a couple of feet down. Again, it's going to depend on the soil, but really it's the extension in terms of having openings for multiple burrows that will go into sort of the main chamber. So it's, yeah, more extension than depth is the key with them. That's why a lot of people don't want them digging under decks or under your house. It's because of that, it's the extension.
Okay. The next one came up several times as well, and it may be too early to know, but it says, you know, bats didn't fare too well in this recent freeze. How did the armadillos do?
Too early to tell. So because it made me worry about, especially as I started thinking, you know, about my talk, and I thought, man, armadillos are just going to take a beating with this cold. I don't know. I'm glad we've moved out of it. I'm hoping that because the burrows were already, you know, in place, and that armadillos are often, you know, will stay in a burrow even when the weather is not as inclement for days at a time before maybe coming out and eating the feed, that if the pregnant females, you know, just kind of held on and we didn't have any early births this month, and that, you know, most of the births are going to happen in March, which is pretty typical. We really won't know, but, you know, it's thought that the distributional limits, so we're seeing that range is continuing to expand, right? So now we can see that they've appeared in the southern tip of Illinois. Now, will they stay there? Will they be permanent components of their wildlife, you know, their fauna? Hard to say, but really that limiting factor is going to be that lengthy cold, and then also soil type and water. But yeah, time will tell on that. I will be, you know, distressed if I don't see, you know, or hear armadillos running around here by the time spring really kicks into gear.
Okay. The next one, there's several that I'm also going to combine together because it got asked several times, is what is the leprosy risk in handling armadillos? And then would eating them expose other creatures or humans to it?
So what's interesting about leprosy, and I figured I'd get a question about it, so I didn't want to launch into it too long because I wanted to make sure that we had plenty of time for questions. But I always think about it when we think about, you know, eating armadillos. And so here's the interesting story. And again, we kind of get into this whole deep time, and it's a reminder about human wildlife relationships and interactions. Is that, first off, so the bacterium that causes leprosy. So it's a mycobacterium. It is not, you know, native to the Americas. So people brought the bacterium that causes Hansen's disease, is what we call the disease itself, leprosy. And it was humans that infected our armadillos. And so we do know, looking at the populations in Southeast Texas and in Louisiana, that we do see armadillos, the populations do have leprosy. And it was first detected in 1975. And so we know at some point, somehow, armadillos, that bacterium was transferred to them, probably from people. Because we do know that there's a, you know, humans, chimpanzees, we do know that mangabey monkeys, apparently there was a transmission probably from humans, that we don't see leprosy, that bacterium kind of widespread in, you know, the animal world, but notably, you know, it's something that we see in the human population and now in armadillos. And we're now seeing it in armadillos in Brazil. So it was 2002. It's a different species. Euphractus, I think, is the type of armadillo that they're seeing this in Brazil. There is a chance, because they're in the population. It's the data that seemed to indicate that if you regularly, you know, hunt and process and eat armadillo, it does up the chances of you possibly then contracting the bacterium that that causes Hansen's disease. The CDC's got a fabulous website that kind of describes all this. It's relatively hard to get and very easily cured. So it's something that, you know, here's the thing. So I have touched a wild armadillo. I've petted one, you know, just reached out just to, you know, do that. But you know what? I washed my hands. So it's just like dealing with any other animals, like wash your hands. So I can't tell you that there is zero chance. There is a chance. And so if you are a regular consumer of wild armadillos, then you have an increased chance of getting infected with the bacterium that causes the Hansen's disease.
Great. The next couple of questions came when you started talking about reproduction and young. The first one is, do fire ants cause problems to young armadillos?
They can. Fire ants seem to cause more havoc with some ground nesting birds and with horned lizards and things. I don't know if I've read any data that specifically documents fire hazard, fire ants as being a problem with the armadillo population. So that would be something I would have to investigate to actually, you know, answer that question.
The next one's interesting. It's something that I haven't thought of before, but when the young leave their mom, one part of it is, where do they go? And the second part of that is, are armadillos territorial?
You know, it's funny, you know, we don't know a lot about armadillo activity and what's going on, and like, we don't recognize what all is happening, you know, obviously underground. We do know from some field studies that the young do kind of hang around with mom for a time. And that's after they've been weaned. It might be a little bit of that mom's picked out this fabulous territory where there's plenty of water and plenty of food, and so they're slowly going to disperse. But, you know, once they are of reproductive age, they're going to move out, right? They're going to move out and look for mates. I don't think anybody's documented any kind of territorial behavior, like actual aggressions. I think you get this kind of, you know, dispersal. And again, it's going to be, you know, food and water resources and the soil type. So I think I mentioned that if you've got some nice sandier soils that you can have, you know, a couple armadillos take over, you know, a couple acres. But if you're in kind of clayey soil, you're going to have a lot more acreage and fewer, you know, armadillos. And so a lot of it is just, you know, resource and then just that natural dispersal to take advantage of resources.
Okay. I think you covered this one a little bit during the talk, but why do you suppose the nine-banded armadillos are not expanding into the West like New Mexico and Arizona?
Water. I think a lot of that's going to be water, because where we see the lack of expansion here in the state of Texas, so, you know, far west Texas and the far western edge of the panhandle, I think it's the aridity is the big issue. So they are, you know, tied to water, and that seems to be kind of one of the big indicators. And they also kind of use those river and stream pathways as, you know, ways to move out. But I think, yeah, moving farther west, I think it's just getting too dry for them.
All right. Next up we have, are there any pain receptors in their armor or in their plating?
So yeah, so not in so much in the armor, but in the connective skin, that's where the armor attaches. So again, since it's loose, so there's probably, you know, that minimal, so the keratinous part is not, that's going to be more of a shielding, but in the internal bone itself, and then in that flesh, from what I understand, where it attaches to the rest of the body, that's where most of those pain receptors are. They can suffer some damage to the shell, And it can be mended, and they do just fine. The big glyptodont that we have at TMM actually has a paleopathology. It has what looks like a big dent where something, I don't know if something smacked into it or some part of the bone got infected, but it actually has, looks like a healed injury to the shell. And so they are capable of with some minor injuries, you know, going forward and surviving. I will say that in the wild, you know, their lifespan's not terribly long. It's about 5 to 7 years. In captivity, obviously, it's a little bit longer, but, you know, the young have to kind of get through that soft baby, you know, period to get through. But once they become adults, it's thought that in the wild that they're living about 5 to 7 years.
Okay. Next up was a follow-up on the territory or range question is, if I remove if I trap one, how far should I take it to relocate it, or any advice on that?
I would double check with Texas Parks and Wildlife, but it's my understanding that relocating wildlife is not something that is recommended.
Good deal.
yep. Like, I would consult with a wildlife professional on that. If you have issues with armadillos, you know, I would just contact a wildlife professional on the best way to deal with that.
Great. Okay, so regarding the beautiful armadillo, is there any evidence that the changing climate has resulted in a change in our nine-banded armadillo's size?
So, I mean, that's part of the kind of this general overarching hypothesis that what we're seeing is if we're going to accept that the beautiful armadillo and the nine-banded armadillo is one and the same species, is that, yeah, that we're seeing a species that is capable of responding to climatic change, and some of those responses include, you know, having a larger body size and being able to successfully live in more northern regions of North America, obviously.
Okay. And then, are the glyptodonts found all over Texas in typical fossil locations for that time period, or are the ones that you listed the only known sites?
Those are the known sites that for this particular species, yeah. Now, we have some older glyptodonts from the Pliocene that come out of West Texas, but I only showed the distribution of our kind of our Pleistocene, our more recent geologically our Pleistocene forms. But the glyptodonts actually came into North America from South and Central America over 3 million years ago.
Okay.
So they have a little bit, you know, so as a whole, if we look at armadillos, that whole family, including the glyptodonts, they have a really rich and a deep fossil history here in Texas.
We're quickly running out of time, so I'm going to get to one more question, and then I'll let Johanna wrap it up if she has anything to add. Do we know the survival rate for the quads of the armadillo? And then what are the young called? Are they pups?
Oh, man. I don't know what they're called. I hope somebody will chime in if they know. I don't know. That's really funny. You think I've always
referred to them as pups, but I'm not sure.
Yeah. I always call them, you know, they're young, but I've never, yeah. I think anybody would accept anything. I think pups would be probably more acceptable than, say, somebody wanted to call them kits, or like, what do you call baby anteaters? See, that's something similar. So yeah, I don't know. And so the question about their survivability, I don't have numbers off the top of my head, but the young do kind of have it much harder. So we do know that there's a lot more evidence now that they are actually, you know, killed by feral hogs, that we're seeing some documentation within Texas of that feral hogs, among the other things that feral hogs do. Do consume them, but they make great prey items for raptors and, you know, mammalian carnivores. And so like a lot of young other, you know, mammals that they do have that higher incidence of not making it into adulthood, but I don't have a number off the top of my head.
Okay, and that's about our time. Johanna, do you have anything to add at the end? If we didn't get to your questions, feel free to contact us or Dr. Owen and we'll see what we can do for you.
Yeah, please send me an email. I'm happy to answer any questions. And thanks for choosing to spend some time learning about armadillos today.